Good evening, Honorable Chief Guest, faculty members, and my fellow student managers. I, Anjali Manwani, take this opportunity to introduce our guest, Mr. Chetan Dixit, for the evening. Introducing such a diversified personality within a short time span wouldn't suffice, but I would try my best. Sir is an Associate Director, Business Intelligence at Ola ANI Technologies Private Limited since 2017. Sir has completed his Bachelor's of Engineering in Computer Science from BMS College of Engineering. Sir has completed his Executive MBA from Indian Institute of Management, Bangalore in 2016. Sir has been the recipient of Customer Award at MicroStrategy World 2019 at Phoenix. He has been a speaker at numerous analytical conferences as Gartner Summit at Global Data Summit held at Las Vegas in 2018 and in B schools. Mr. Chetan Dixit, sir, has served as a program manager for data platform and he also product owner of a BI platform. He has also a spearheaded complex transformation programs by working with CXO, business product, engineering, data science team. Sir has been a CXO level stakeholder management for analytic programs across group of companies spanning Ola Cabs, Food Panda, Ola Fleet Technologies, Ola Money and electrical vehicle units. Also, sir has led Business Intelligence Central of Excellence Analytical Team, developed strategic vision execution of data initiatives, managing high-performing team of business analysts, BI developers, ETL pipeline engineers. Sir has successfully delivered numerous unified BI and KPI standardized projects. Sir, we are really honored to have you with us today. The stage is all yours.
The first thing I know all of you have in your mind is, ye kitna aur pakayega, right? So I promise, it's an honest promise from my side, 30 minutes. After that, I'll open it up to Q&A. And after 30 minutes, I'll take a poll. If you want me to continue, I'll extend it by 10, 15 minutes max, right? Because it's not the length of the program, but the effectiveness of it is, you know, and the takeaways. And like Mr. Sahil said, if I can interest at least 1% of the audience here to move towards analytics, then I have done my job pretty effectively, right? So that was a pretty long introduction. I'm still a student of analytics, and this is not my humility, because it's just that analytics is such a vast field, and we are still in the early stages, at least in India, in terms of understanding what analytics can actually deliver for us. So what I'm going to do is use the Ola example or the Ola business case study and try and explain to you how analytics has actually helped us take some critical decisions when it comes to running the business. So I don't think it comes as a surprise to anybody. We are the world's leading ride-hailing company. There are very few players in the market. You know the competition in India. There is also a Southeast competitor called Grab, and then there is Gojek. These are some of the lesser-known competitors because they don't have a presence in India. So Gojek is really huge in Indonesia, for example. So that's a little bit about myself. So, quick introduction about the company. These are our various product offerings. I'll take a minute or two to explain this, just to set the context. So we have, recently launched. I think the presentation there is not complete. It's okay, I think you can focus here. So we have bikes, autos, and point-to-point rides, the traditional rental and outstation, which is the traditional cab business. We also have, apart from bike taxis, we also have acquired a new company called Vogo, which is, you ride your own bike. You know, instead of taking it as a taxi, you rent a bike and, you know, you probably want to go to some hill station, maybe Lonavala, and so you just, it's a self-driven bike. So that's Vogo. Is there a problem with the mic? Is there an echo or something? There is? Is it better? Any improvement? Okay. I was just explaining some of the product offerings that we have. I mean, I'm pretty sure most of you would have used Ola at some point in time. If not, you know, there is some problem with us or with you, that we'll find out, and only analytics can help us figure that out. And then there is the traditional rental and outstation business that I was talking about. We also run a lot of loyalty programs in the form of Select, you know, where we assign priority booking to customers who pay us an upfront money. So these are some of the product offerings in a gist. So I just wanted to say, you know, everybody hears the data, hears the word big data. You know, I just wanted to showcase whether really, you know, how big we really are, right? I would like to take your, eyesight towards the trivia 1 and 2, right? This is just an analysis that we did a couple of days ago, just to give people a perspective, right? If all cars on the Ola platform are made to stand in one line, it'll cover from Kashmir to Kanyakumari, right? That's the number of vehicles that are there on the platform. And if you look at the number of kilometers that we clock on a daily basis, it is 10 times the distance between moon and the earth. So it is big business, it is big data business as well, right? Most of these companies, at least the internet-based e-commerce companies, data is blood, data is brain, data is everything, right? There are no decisions that are taken without being justified with data. So that's how much emphasis and importance is placed on the need for data and data-driven decisions as well. So we have millions of customers using the platform daily. We have 1 million driver partners. We call them partners in the organization because every job is respectable, and we treat it that way. Round-the-clock operations in 150 cities. I'll talk about some of the technical details in a bit. And we have thousands of offers and campaigns running on a daily basis. So, we look at every customer differently. We look at, we create actually segments of customers. More about that a little later. And we have a petabyte of storage, right? And for those of you who are from a non-technical background, there is bytes, kilobytes, megabytes, gigabytes, terabytes, and then petabytes. So that's the level of data volume that is captured, stored, processed, analyzed, visualized, modeled, and business decisions are taken based on that. Right? No data, no decisions. And 5 billion events. So what do you mean by events? I'll make it very non-technical. By events, so every time you launch an Ola app, an event gets triggered to the backend. Every time you click on right now, I get an event. Every time you click on confirm booking, I get an event. So we get 5 billion events daily, and that's massive. So the three V's at the bottom, is volume, variety, and velocity. That is what defines big data systems. How much volume is coming in, what is the variety of data, and how quickly is it coming in, right? These are the three metrics based on how big data is actually measured. All right, so let's get the audience involved. So I want somebody or any of you to give me two words to describe what analytics means. And if what is there on the slide is the answer that you give, I'll give you 100 rupees in Ola money. It's for real, real cash. So you can use it to pay your electricity bill. You can use it to pay for your Ola ride. Or you can treat a friend, whatever. There are two phrases actually. Both of them will come up on the screen, but I just want the audience to try and give me some answer. Just shout it out. Data and interpretations, okay, what else? I want the right word, just the one word. It's okay. make you know, that's close but not close enough. Data mining, okay. What else? Okay, can I increase the stake? Maybe 200 rupees in Ola Money. That's more into onto the technology side. So, okay, let me give you a hint. So, we are not looking for technical terms. We are not looking at any management terms. We're purely looking at, you know, if you were to oversimplify analytics, if you were to explain to a layman what analytics means, what word would you use? Okay? Analyzing and prediction. Filtering. Fantastic. I got one answer. Problem solving. Great. I'll take your number later and transfer the Ola money. One more word remaining. Problem solving is one term. There is another term. Decision making. Not close enough. Saving time. Relevant data. Close but not close enough. Choices, sampling. Okay, one more hint. What are we doing all this for? Customer, no. Rider, targeting the audience. Okay, this is slightly difficult, so maybe 300 rupees in Ola money. That's the best I can do. Organizing, forecasting. What are we trying to achieve out of all this? Okay, too many answers. Simplifying, customer satisfaction. Okay, final clue. So, you want to teach a concept to let's say your somebody elderly in your family, maybe mother, father. What would you do to explain that concept? Example? Simplify? Summarizing? Almost there. No, you're trying to explain a difficult concept to somebody who doesn't understand anything. What do you do to them? How do you make them explain? Can't hear you. Little louder, please. Communication. Okay. Guide. Almost there. Can you extend your thought a little bit? Guide. Okay, give away clue. Okay, give away clue. I have to teach you something, or somebody has to teach me something. What do they do? This. Okay, I'll give you the closest word. Demonstrate. If a creative person were to demonstrate, how would he demonstrate? Example, what? More. You guys are almost there. Bol do. Sorry? Finding patterns in data, but all that is very technical. I can't tell my mother I'm trying to find patterns in data. Social? Guys, think I'm Sanjay Leela Bansali. Now I can't hear anything. What would Sanjay Leela Bhansali do? Narrate. Narration. Okay, I don't know who to give the prize to, but you guys almost got it. I told you it was a difficult one, but honestly guys, you get your 200. I get to keep the other 200, right? If anybody tells you anywhere in the world that analytics is anything apart from these two words, we can have a debate, right? I want to simplify it in the most simplest of terms. This is analytics. Everybody likes a story. My mother likes a story. My boss likes a story, right? But the story is incomplete without, you know, its ability to actually solve a problem. If I want to present a new business proposition to my CEO, he'll say, okay, apni kahani batao. And then he'll ask me to justify that with data, right? So analytics is all about how effectively you can tell stories through data. That's all it is, guys. The rest is all excess gyan. So I just extended the concept a little more. It's objectivity and creativity. In the end, what I'm trying to communicate is, it is the function of the left brain and of the right brain. Right? You guys know the left brain, right brain wala concept, right? Left brain is logical, right brain is more creative and all of that. You need to have both bends of mind to actually be successful in analytics, right? Or a little bit of both. So thanks for the participation. Only one person won it, but it was some of you got close when you said narration. So, oh shucks, I made a mistake. I was going to ask you another question as to what is at the core of all this. You obviously, right? So that's pretty obvious. Now that you understood data is at the core of everything, let's also try and understand how data actually moves through the system, right? Data also has a journey, just like you make a journey in Ola cab. And like I said, you know, the most beaten to death concept in most e-commerce companies is data-driven decision making, data first. We are a data first company. Obviously, everybody from 1970s has been a data first company. It is just that, you know, it has got a new name, more fancy, probably higher salaries and all of that. But this is an evolution of what we already had, not new. So you have, you know, I met Soumyadeep and Anjali in the morning. They picked me up from the airport. So they taught me about the three Ds of Balaji. So discipline, determination. So we also have DDD here. Right, data-driven decisions. So what happens to data, right? From its nascent stage, from its seed stage to its fruit stage. Data is first captured, stored, analyzed, visualized, modeled, and decisions are taken. Let's look at each of these in a little bit more detail. Capture, again, taking the Ola use case. I told you we capture 5 billion events from users and from drivers on a daily basis. Why do we do that? Because every activity on the platform is trying to tell me some story from the user or some story from the driver. At what point in time did he come to the platform? At what point in time did he drop off from the platform? Was there an issue on my side with the way I manage supply, with the way I manage my pricing, with the way I manage my allocation? It tells me all of this, and that is the reason I capture data, not because I have a liking for data. Second, obviously this tons of data, it has to find its place. So storage is the home for data, and the big data systems are so advanced these days, they let you store petabytes of data in a cloud environment. Okay, we are on Amazon Web Services, it's a cloud provider. We are hosted on AWS across the world. We have data centers in Singapore and Mumbai. And these are geographically spread, disaster resilient. So we have signed an agreement with Amazon for 5-9 reliability. You guys know what 5-9 is? It means Amazon has to give us 99.999% availability and reliability of data, right? And that costs money, because if there is a data loss, you know, they would have replicated it into multiple systems, mirrored it, and that costs hardware, and that costs money, right? So that's about storage. There are big data systems which enable distributed storage and parallelized processing of data. So that's on the engineering side. Analysis, probably very relevant to this audience. You talk about once the data has found its home, now let me start using a lens to find my story from data, right? Again, it's coming back to stories. So you have to be you know, slightly out of the box in terms of figuring out different stories. Otherwise, you know, what is there in an Ola cab business? Koi book karta hai, koi ride leta hai, khatam hai na. But obviously, that is what it is. The core business model is still that. But it gets complex when you're dealing with hundreds of millions of customers, 1 million plus partners. And that is where you need to have a different viewing lens for different personas of users, for different personas of drivers, right? And that's where the analysis happens, and that's where analysis plays a role. The next step is visualization. We have different types of visualization. I'll quote two examples. And visualization, typically you must have heard of tools like Tableau, Power BI, MicroStrategy. These are the visualization tools that I'm talking about, where your data is actually in a visually appealing form that your senior leaders can understand. You know, you show trend lines of bookings, you show a stack chart of how different customers are stacking up. And the most important and interesting visualization that we have done is what we call as a funnel analysis. Nothing fancy about it, but it is core to how we run the business. So I told you about, you know, user clicking on opening the app, clicking on right now, clicking on confirm. Then he confirms, he gets a cab, it gets canceled, or the ride gets completed. You know, the whole workflow happens. Now, what does funnel analysis help us with is understanding at what stage or at what point in time is the user dropping off, right? And that tells me a big story. I'll give you an example. You launched the app, you looked at mini, micro, prime, blah, blah, blah. The ETA was shown as 20 minutes. Arre yaar, itna kaun wait karega, drop off. Step one of drop off. So ETA is a problem. If ETA is a problem, then what is the problem? Supply is a problem, right? I don't have enough cabs for you to reach your pickup point on time. I probably have to get a cab from a geographical area 3 kilometers or 4 kilometers away, and hence the ETA is higher. So that tells me that there is a supply issue in that area. Okay, right now is good, but confirm booking has an issue. Why? Because between right now and confirm booking, I show you the price of that ride. If you drop off at that point, then I know that I have messed up in my pricing algorithm. Second story. Price is also good. I booked the cab, but the cab did not get allocated. Why? Maybe I stocked out. There are 10 users, I have 2 cars, the other 8 users go back empty-handed. So that tells me what? Again, a supply issue, right? So at every stage, like I said, in the funnel, I know as to where is my platform-related problem. So that's one visualization. More about visualizations later. Finally, modeling. Everybody wants to become a data scientist, at least in Bangalore that is a scene, because it's the sexiest job available, high-paying salaries. But very few people or very few companies do modeling for the real use cases of modeling, right? We were pretty slow in adopting data modeling because we thought, let us first understand our customers first. Now that we have a big customer base, the next step is understanding patterns in reams and reams of data, right? And that's where modeling plays a big role. I was talking to the senior batch about an hour ago, and we discussed about 8 or 10 use cases where Ola uses data modeling to take day-to-day decisions. Again, we can talk about it if data science is of interest to people, maybe at the fag end of the session. And all this leads to what? Taking decisions, right? I don't want to collect data to become a great business scientist. Ultimately, everything is costing money, right? In every step in the process costs money. It costs me money to decide what to capture. It costs me money in terms of dollars to store that data. Costs me business analyst ka salary to analyze data. Costs me BI experts ka salary to tools and the licenses to visualize. So I'm not doing this for some kick or fun. Ultimately, it has to give me a good decision on the business, right? That's why we do this whole jhamela of these 5-6 steps. And at the end of the decision making, I realize two things. Either the data that I'm capturing is useful or it's useless. If it's useful, I'll collect more of it. If it is useless, I'll trash it, right? And that's where the cycle continues. That is what this slide is all about. So let me, again, I mean, I'm in the habit of simplifying things. So I want to talk about analytics with, again, the Ola use case in mind. So every time you have a, you know, let's say tomorrow you land up in a company and the first assignment is that of an analytics assignment. So you don't know where to start. This will help you where to start with, right? Look at the company in its entirety. Once you understood the business model, the next thing you'll try and understand is what are the various entities at play, okay? These are either business entities or you could translate them into data entities. Once we talk about the examples, it'll become clear. So business entities, what do we have in Ola? All four are listed there. There's a user who books the ride, there's a driver, partner who, we call them partners, like I said, respectfully, who delivers the ride, and there is cars, which is also an asset. So all of your MBA students, I don't have to tell you how deeply you'll have to analyze your assets. You know, most important metrics like return on assets, salvage value, depreciation, all of that has to be looked at. So look at what are the assets in your company, you know, where the receivables are, where the payables are, and you'll have your entities all mapped out. And finally, in e-commerce kind of a setting, there is also a concept of a platform, right? So platform or marketplace, these are interchangeably used. What these essentially mean is, I'm giving you a platform. So this is really like a platform. The driver comes in, the customer comes in, I am the mediator, I am the broker who enables that transaction. So a platform is also an entity, and platform has its own set of matrices that has to be analyzed. In the next slide, we talk about what are those metrics, right? I've only given a few examples in the interest of time. So let's head straight to the platform. User and driver, you probably understand. So from a platform point of view in Ola, these are the main level zero metrics, as we call them. My CEO looks at these metrics on a daily basis, sometimes multiple times daily, because now we are in multiple countries. So gross merchandise value. Everybody understands that? Or nobody understands that? Okay, I'll explain. So it is actually an e-commerce specific metric. What that means is, so let's take the Flipkart example. Flipkart sold a mobile phone worth 10,000 rupees. This gross merchandise value is 10,000 rupees. It is as simple as that, because they sold a merchandise on their platform and the price of which is 10,000. But obviously, is Flipkart making 10,000? No, Samsung is, right? But Flipkart gets a commission as a retailer. So that commission then becomes what? The revenue for that company. So 10,000, so typical, if you assume a 20% commission for a retailer, be it e-commerce or any retailer, so 2,000 rupees is what Flipkart earns. Coming back to the Ola example, 100 rupees is the booking that you make. Do I get 100 rupees? Obviously not, because I have to pay the driver. So typically we take about 10 to 20% varying across regions and all of that from the driver. So whatever I take as a commission is my revenue. So GMV is that, revenue is that. An average ticket size is simple as gross merchandise value divided by the total number of transactions. Transaction in my case is bookings. So that gives me the average ticket size. So typically if you take a city like Pune, the average ticket size could be somewhere around 175 to 200 rupees. In a city like Mumbai, it's a little higher because it's a lengthy city. right? And hence the distance is higher and hence the ticket sizes are higher. GTR, gross take rate, ENTR, effective net take rate, EBITDA, I'm sure everybody understands. So gross take rate is, in this case, is the 20 rupees that I take. ENTR is, so once I take 20 rupees, that 20 rupees is also all not all mine. Why? Because I have to pay incentive to the driver. I have to pay some discount to the customer. So minus both of that gives me ENTR. So I'm just trying to, I don't want to explain every metric. That is not the purpose of this. It is just that, just to give you an idea of the number of metrics that we have to show and present and report on a daily basis across entities. So every time you start an analytics assignment or a project, start with the entities at play, look at what are the various metrics in terms of how you measure that entity. So this is the technically the last slide, right? I can spend 1 hour about on this or 5 minutes. 5 minutes is good, right? I heard five. So these are every block that I've listed here is a business decision that we take, right? If as a company we are not growing, then the data that we are collecting is useless. So company ke hisab se growth is the number one growth and profitability, you can call it. Second, customer behavior. In a day, we run about anywhere between 1,000 to 1,500 distinct marketing campaigns. And I'm only able to do that because I understand the customer's behavior distinctly. In this room, if I have the data, I can bifurcate you or categorize you or bucketize you into probably about, in a room of this size, about 20 buckets. Because there are 20 different thinking patterns, 20 different needs for each of us, and 20 different affordabilities, all of that, right? All of that is what makes a user segment. We generally collect about 40 to 60 user attributes, and I had this question in the previous session. The kind of data that we collect are two types. One is what the user is willing to give on their own, right? You typically give a lot of information when you sign up on the app. And second is what we call as derived data. So there is profile data, there is derived data. Profile data is what on your own you gave me. Derived data is from that, how am I able to extract more information about you. One example, income group. Obviously at any point in time, I don't ask you what is your income. But I still try and bucketize you under various income groups so that I can send out different kind of marketing campaigns. For somebody with a, let's say, low to medium income group, micro is the right offering. For somebody with a high income group, prime, you get the point. Now, how am I able to do this when you don't give me this data? That is where machine learning models play a big role, right? Obviously, you've given some data. Like, for example, when you're trying to book a ride, I know what mobile phone you're booking it from. So let's say you booked it from an iPhone or a OnePlus 7. I know that you're, somebody who is willing to spend, somebody who has some financial muscle. So I put you there. Or second data point, where is your home location? Typically, where are the bookings that you typically do from? So that, again, so these are, what is important to learn about these data points is the model or the algorithm ka output need not be 100% accurate, right? What is important when it comes to data science models or algorithms is not their accuracy, it is their consistency, right? Consistently, if I am able to deliver 80%+ accuracy based on the data points that I collected to bucketize you into the right income group, then I accept that model as fair and I will deploy that model across multiple cities. So that's typically how most companies do. You don't obviously start a big bang rollout. You start small. You test it out in a very controlled environment, as we call it. See what is the, see how the model is behaving. And then if and constantly fine tune it and then do a mega rollout. And then again, there are other nitty-gritties. such as what I use to decide income groups in India will not work in Australia, will not work in the UK, because you know, the user behavior is different, and our very personas are different, and hence the data science model has to be very different. It's like a horses for courses kind of an approach. You have to, it's not a one size fits all. So much about customer behavior. Same set of things apply even on the partner side, right? How do I incentivize them? Some people are greedy for incentives, some people are not. Some people are very loyal to the platform. So based on who you are, I try and give you the, you know, right incentive. So incentive doesn't always mean money. So if I have a consistently 5-star driver, money is not the motivation factor for him, right? Probably something else is. What? Maybe insurance for his family, right? So those are some of the ways we look at creative.
So now we'll have Q&A. I'll take the last 5 minutes. Actually, I might need 10 minutes. And then loyalty programs, right? We run various loyalty programs. One of the most common one that you must have heard is Pass, right? And then there is Pass is an example that we got directly out of public transport. You have metro passes, you have bus passes, you have railway passes. Why not a cab pass, right? So for those of the customers who were loyal to the customer, loyal to the platform, we wanted to incentivize them further by taking more and more bookings. And for them, we said, you know, sometimes when you book from point A to point B, you either pay 80 rupees, 100 rupees, 120, 140, depending on surge pricing. Rather, when you buy a pass and you pay 85 rupees consistently, right? No peak hour, no surcharge, none of that business. Similar loyalty program is also Ola Select, where we give priority allocation to the customers who have signed up. Select is usually given to customers who are a little more premium segment, who consistently book prime and prime play kind of rides. And that is obviously priced a little steeper as well. Supply shaping, maybe I'll skip that. Pricing and allocation, I think this is a fun topic, right? So is there anybody who loves surge pricing? Loves surge pricing, loves peak pricing, loves when your Ola rides cost higher than they normally do. Yeah. So let me try to explain as to why it actually happens, right? We are in a demand-supply equilibrium kind of a business, right? If I don't price it right, then it'll be a state of inequilibrium. And you know, the law of physics states that it is not right to have an inequilibrium. And even economic sense, right? If there are higher demand sessions, there is a higher demand in that area, so the product becomes premium at that point in time, right? So that's why you know, peak pricing is applied. Pricing, the most how I simplified analytics, if I were to simplify pricing, it is a function of demand over supply. That's all it is, right? So you may hit peak pricing, but that's the nature of the business. And allocation, so when it comes to allocation, there are various metrics coming at play, right? You asked for a prime, but oh, sorry, I gave you an indica. So that's wrong allocation, right? So allocation is also a machine-driven algorithm to see exactly what the customer is asking for and to meet that demand or fulfill that demand with the exact product that the customer wants. Then there are more, and then finally, you know, I'll end this slide by talking about safety, right? In an ecosystem like India, where you know the social issues, safety for our kind of platform is right here, you know? It's bigger than growth, it's bigger than profitability, because it is a matter of reputation for us. That, how does data enable that? That'll be a good example. So every 5 seconds, we collect a ping. You know, ping is a technical term where a driver device communicates with our platform saying, hey, I'm alive, hey, I'm here in this location. So every 5 seconds that happens. So let's say somebody booked their cab, male, female, doesn't matter. And so he has to go from point A to point B. What we do is we map 3 different routes between point A to point B. And then through data, we figure out the route given versus the route taken. If there is a deviation, if there is an anomaly, immediately an SOS gets triggered to our call center, right? And this happens in real time, because safety is a real time issue, right? You can't say I will deal with it tomorrow. And that is how the big data systems, that is how the real time systems are actually helping with real life issues, like this one. We also have an algorithm. Okay, maybe I'll skip that example. It's a little not so easy to stomach, but I'll skip that example. So, yeah, that's about safety. You understood how data helps in making the ride safer, right? So, that's about it. So, I just want to leave you with this thought, right? So much being discussed about data analytics and all of that. So, for our kind of companies, data is like an asset in the balance sheet. And data is also the new oil, right? Maybe I'll open it for questions. That's all I had. I mean, I had some auxiliary slides, but I think we are running out of time. So this was just to talk about what are the various career options available within the analytics space. Would that be a useful slide? Okay. So this is industry standard, right? This is not just my slide. This is how the industry recognizes the various skills that are available pertaining to analytics. At the core of it, or at the nucleus of it, is what we call as the data platform, right? This is the set of tools and technologies, like I talked to you about, in terms of helping with how to scan and process, analyze and visualize tons of data. So this is the distributed systems. These are the parallel processing systems. This is a skill which requires engineering skills, core engineering skills, right? Maybe not relevant, but this is a common slide which I use even in the IITs. So that is about the engineering platform. Second is probably the most relevant to at least 50% of the audience here, which is the business analytics stream, as a career path. So this is where you actually talk to data systems. You talk to data systems by asking queries, just like, you know, how I ask you a question, you give me an answer. It works the same way even in the data side. You ask a system a query, it will respond back to you with data. And that is what this discipline is about, this career path is about, in terms of am I able to get the right data? Am I creatively able to find new data points to capture? Am I creatively able to look at the same data with a different perspective? That is what this is about. And in the end, the outcome is, you know, you create a dashboard, a fun-looking visualization, etc. And then the last or the topmost layer, which I said is the sexiest layer in the last 10 years, is data science. Less understood, at least in India. And it's still in its nascent form. You know, there are multiple things that AI can do. It's just that you know, we are not there yet in terms of, because we're still dealing with day-to-day stuff. So what do you, who are the kind of people who do machine learning? So these are essentially statisticians, mathematicians, who can actually extract patterns from data by running a model on top of it. Just a show of hands, how many of you understand models such as random forest? Okay, very few, okay. So then, you know, let's just skip it because, but just understand that these are the various career options. For most MBA students or even engineering graduates, the middle layer is the most appealing, right? And the middle layer is how you start your analytical career, right? Because you can't become a data engineer because it requires core engineering skills, but you can definitely aim at a career in business analytics. So this is just a Gyan slide, right? So I just try to Balaji-fy it to make it relevant to everybody. So in an early stage of your career, if you have an idea or if you have a thought, what I would recommend is, you know, you should really think big. but start small, right? No job is, you know, less or more. As long as you've identified what is your true calling, right? And now I'm talking like the HR. So try and figure out what is it that you always wanted to do, what drives you. And then if you want to take the entrepreneurial journey, what you need to do is you need to enroll more people. You can't be an entrepreneur all by yourself, right? You need co-founders, you need partners, you need tons of people to work for you. Like I can give, just to lighten up the mood a little, I can give you a quick story about how Ola actually started, right? So my CEO, Bhavish Agarwal, so just like how you guys all respect Bala sir, that is the kind of respect our CEO commands in the organization. He's a visionary. You must have seen him in the newspapers numerous times. So his idea of starting a cab hailing platform started about 10 years ago. And it is a very funny incident that happened. So he was in Bangalore working for Microsoft in the R&D department. He was taking a vacation to Mysore, which is 140 kilometers away. And the driver abandoned him midway, right? And he said, if this can happen to me, it can happen to anybody. How can I now build a platform which is secure, reliable, works consistently day on day, right? And that was the genesis of Ola. There were no apps that time. It was only call centers. Apps only came in 5 years, 5 years ago. So that is just to say that if you have an idea, and in the end, if you have a passionate mind, because ideas, you know, I have 10 ideas right now, and I can share that with you in the room. But ideas are meaningless unless, you know, it is executed right. You must have heard this a lot of times, but it is still the most important truth in the industry. I have, you know, I work in my company. Every second person is from IIT. Every second person is from IIM. Everybody has ideas, but only, you know, to make it successful, it's the big bubble there, right? That's the bubble most people, you know, underestimate, and that's where many ideas fail, right? Even till date, if you ask my CEO, he's just as passionate as he was 10 years ago in terms of growing the business and, you know, making customers happy. That's it.
The house is now open for the question and answer session.
Maybe I'll just walk on the floor and hand over the mic myself. Sorry. Oh, okay. No, it's okay. I like getting up close and personal with students.
Thank you so much, sir. Musicians play the music, I play the orchestra. I want to be polite with you. Don't make me skip your dinner. Sorry. I will be asking more and more and more and more, so let's not interrupt when I'm talking.
Wow, that's some tashin.
So my question for you is that I'm from commerce background. In the market, it's asking about data managers, and rather we have been gone and we are making to go with a curriculum which is not data oriented, which is actually a total management. So I'm from a commerce background, even we have not been made. I'm not talking on the behalf of my school, I'm talking on the behalf of all the B schools in India, that we are not made to choose analytics if you're not from engineer's background. In that case, we miss Python, SAS, Tableau, R, and these are some coding paths that we miss in the curriculum. What I'm saying is that if you're missing these things, and we are heading towards something, as you are saying, it's booming in the market. How to be able to cooperate with it? Because I also want to be a data manager, but at the same point of time, my curriculum is not allowing me to do that. Thank you.
Sure.
Hello. Great question, right? So analytics is like democracy. It's for everybody, right?
everyone gets to vote, so everybody gets to enjoy the riches of analytics. If you're a marketing manager, can you take a decision without data? You can't. If you're HR, can you take decisions without employee or employee behavior data? No. So the point of the matter is analytics is everywhere. Now, when it comes to the technical skills, yes, I agree that you know commerce students don't have the relevant skill set from a technical point of view. However, in my organization, like I said, there are people who have a commerce background, probably did an MBA from somewhere, and the kind of roles that they are performing right now is on the business side. So let me also take a minute to explain how companies like us are organizationally structured. Then you can probably understand where you fit in, right? So there are three pillars in our company. Maybe the people on top can't see me, but it's okay, you can still hear me. There are three pillars. The first pillar is where engineers have a disadvantage, is the business pillar. The second pillar is product, and the third pillar is technology, right? Most of what I focused today was on the product and engineering side. But really, data is collected to solve a business problem that we understood today, right? And that's where data managers on the business side can actually make that difference. You don't need to necessarily know how to analyze the data, but are you able to make a story out of it? Obviously you can, because you understand metrics, you understand how to look at entities and how to understand the health of each of these entities, right? And that is where you can come in as a business leader and say, look, my goal is safety, my goal is growth, my goal is profitability. You, product manager, figure out the data that is required to make my business successful or my business goal successful. And that's where you look at data and then you take a business. People like you who want to be in business with data, you know what you would start with? You would start with actually storytelling, right? The more apt term here is hypothesis, right? You make a hypothesis looking at the data and say, this is how I think, or this is where I think we should be growing. This is the geography where I think we are not doing well for so and so reasons. You build hypothesis. And then you ask the product and the analytical guys to actually test your hypothesis, right? So you're far from being handicapped. You still have the advantage of looking at data and making your hypothesis. Does that answer your question? Cool.
So, in the balcony.
Hello.
Hello, sir, in this street.
Yeah, I'll come up. No, I'll come up as in here.
Probably. Yes, sir, sure.
Yeah, please.
So my name is Mayank Raina.
Hi, Mayank.
How are you, sir?
How am I?
Yes, sir.
I'm doing pretty very well. Thanks for all the hospitality. And I have two friends of mine to thank, Anjali and Shomedeep.
Good, sir. So my question falls into product enhancement. Like I have an account, Ola account, in that if I have outstanding amount, so in India, more than 90% people are using dual SIM mobile. So I just switch my account to another account and I use that every feature of your application with the another account.
Mm-hmm.
So why your data is not helping in that manner? Like I can use both the accounts simultaneously. If I have one account with the outstanding amount, I skip that part. I'll go to another account. I use all the features with that account. So why data is not helping in that?
No, so I probably did not understand the question. So are you not able to...
No, I have two accounts. Right?
Yeah.
I'm using smartphone, which is a dual SIM smartphone. Right. So from one SIM, I have an Ola account, which have some outstanding amount in it. So I switch, I off that account, I use another account with another number, with another email ID, and I use all the features of it. So it creates a loss of Ola, right? So why data is not helping in that?
It is of course helping. I mean, we so things like these, we call them as fraud, broadly. No. I mean, it's you may not be doing it, or whoever is doing it, it's okay. I mean, we have frauds in the system. I'm not shying away from that. So there is a way to deal with this as well, right? I mean, if you abandon the platform from one number, right, there is no way you can come back because you are a blacklisted user. So that's how, from data, we are able to ward off fraudulent users.
But sir, I can use another number.
You can, but that is a different identity, right? I don't know how you acquired the SIM.
No, that's actually, sir, I paid a Ola driver, and actually that time it's showing paid, but after some time when I open the app, it's showing outstanding amount in it. So I switched from that account to another account. It's just easy, like I can access all the features.
Correct.
So it's create a loss in Ola.
Yeah. So it is not that these things go undetected, right? It is, I can right away tell you an algorithm which can actually detect this fraud. Very simple algorithm. So Mayank, what's your full name?
Mayank Raina.
So, let's say you have two SIM cards. Mayank Raina, SIM card 1. Mayank Raina, SIM card 2. Obviously, maybe there's a good chance that your home location has not changed.
Yes, sir.
There's a good chance. So, I can look at three data points together. Name, first name, comma, last name, comma, phone number, comma, pickup location. If two out of these three match, and if one of the SIM is abandoned with a default or with a credit balance negative, I know that it's the same person.
Yes, sir. So why we are not using that?
No, we are. Okay. Have you done that fraud?
Yeah, actually, it's outstanding 120, and I paid it.
No, but the next time you come back, it'll pop you up to pay up.
Yeah, I paid it already. It's
okay. Okay, that's good. Thank you for that.
Sir, here to your right. Good evening, sir. My name is Simran Modi, and my question is, Uber is one of the strongest competitors of Ola today. So which are all those challenges faced by Ola, and if Ola has coped them, how?
Actually, you should be asking that question to Uber, because we have solved more challenges than they have. Honestly. Now, I can give you examples. It's not just a boasting or a bragging session, right? I can give you examples. Example number one, auto. Auto is a very Indian, very, very Indian thing. So we introduced auto way before Uber did, because we understood the challenges in the market. If I can do a cab booking, why not an auto? And now why not a bike, right? So I don't know how much I can talk about the competitor, but one thing I can definitely tell you, that it is a deep-pocketed competition, right? They earn in dollars, we earn in rupees. So obviously they are at an advantage. Their ability to burn cash is much higher than ours. So, but it doesn't take away the fact that we are doing more bookings than them in India. And it's a fact. So challenges, of course, we could have more supply challenges than the competition. And the reason for that is, like I said, they probably can pay the driver a little more than what we can offer. However, we are trying to address that challenge, to answer your question, by doing other things. If you really understand drivers and their mentality, what they want beyond money is some kind of a financial security, some kind of a financial education, right? So we have started to do all of those soft things better. We look at how can I ensure the partner and his family, okay, so that his loyalty to our platform is beyond incentives, beyond money, right? So that's some of the non-technical ways of addressing those challenges. I mean, there are more examples, but I think in the interest of time, this should be good.
Hello, sir. Sir, in the balcony. Sir, my question is, like, Flipkart already sold, and like many Indian entrepreneurs, once they start the company and once the company get the unicorn tag, then they start to think or like they should sell the company. So many entrepreneurs like FreeCharge, Flipkart, like big companies, they grown very fast, but suddenly they plan, and many big giants come like Walmart and this kind of company came and they acquired them. So do you think like Bhavesh Agarwal also, Uber would buy the Ola, do you think that Bhavesh Agarwal also
go with this strategy? Like, sell the company and get the money and enjoy his life.
Only one word, never. So, we are here to stay. We are here to stay. And you can, again, don't take my word. Look at where we are spreading. You know, we are spreading in Australia, in UK. We only recently got a license to operate in London. So we are, you know, taking the bull by its horns. You know, we are not afraid of the competition because we believe we've understood the cab market really well, because if you can solve India, you can probably solve the world, right?
So I hope so. Like Uber will become the world's largest ride sharing.
Ola.
And not Uber. Sorry for my mistake.
It's okay.
I hope so. Thank you, sir.
Hello. Good evening, sir. My name is Diksha Pahuja. And
Diksha,
my question to you is, sometime back, Ola launched Ola Autos in countries abroad, like in the US. So I wanted to know, was it really a marketing strategy, a strong marketing strategy, or has Ola Autos really picked up?
Marketing is your main strength, right?
Yes.
I mean, have you chosen marketing as a specialized?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, you got it right.
Yes.
It is just that. It is just a marketing gimmick, because
yes,
We wanted to announce our presence in the UK.
Yes.
And these kind of gimmicks actually help. You know, it gets people's attention. And see, I'll give you one perspective. When we went international, there was one driving factor, right? And that is the Indian diaspora in those countries. So you can actually see. And one more interesting trivia is all four World Cup semi-final teams is where Ola operates in. Right, you have Australia, New Zealand, UK, and India. So, and we it was a very careful decision to choose these countries over, you know, other countries or other markets. And that is the reason, because we believe that the Ola brand resonates with Indians, not just in India, but also outside. And that's where, and marketing campaigns such as these, you know, because auto is something that every Indian can immediately associate with.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir.
You can ask the question, I'll repeat it. Which city? Hubli.
So, how do you overcome such kind of problems in small cities where the unions are strong?
Yeah. So the question was, in tier 2 cities where the traditional unions are very strong, you know, they are like a very close-knit community and they don't want an outside player to just come and grab their market. These are things that happen only in the initial stages, right? Be it Hubli, be it Mangalore, be it Nagpur, any other city. These things don't last long, because eventually, these guys understand that it is not a competition, it is a partner, right? They are not coming to take away your business, they are coming to give you more business, right? And that is the kind of education that happens while we onboard these autos. Whether it is small or big cities, the problems remain the same, right? You try and convince them that this is an alternative channel for you to get bookings, right? You might be sitting somewhere in the remotest part of the city and suddenly you get a booking, which you wouldn't normally get, right? So that education from our side to these driver partners has actually helped. And eventually they get the confidence that yes, these guys are not here to take away my business, but if I partner with them, then I get to earn more and, you know, have a better livelihood. Cool. I think we are at the end of it. Cool. Thank you, guys.